to start? Good evening, everyone. I would now like to welcome Brad Fenty, a talented Saskatoon bagpiper who has played with the Royal Wind Orchestra. A special thanks to Brad for stepping in this evening, as our alumnus bagpiper, Anthony Lofen, was unable to attend due to being sick. Please stand as we welcome our honored guests, dignitaries, and bagpiper, Brad Fenty. Thank you, and please be seated. According to Scottish tradition, we will now pray Brad with a shot of scotch to show our appreciation for bagpiping for us tonight.
Slanjava.
So now we would go back to the question we asked everybody before. Jay, what would you do if you had $10 million?
Well, if I had $10 million, I'd do many things. But the first thing I would do is to get windows installed on the engineering building.
Well said.
So how's everyone doing tonight? Good? Folks, that's not going to cut it today. So let's do this. This side of the room, how is everyone doing tonight? That's much better, much better. So this side of the room, can you beat them? How is everyone doing tonight? And now everyone together, how's everyone doing tonight? That was much better, don't you think? Maybe not Dean's List, but I'll give you a 75%. Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pride and pleasure that we welcome you all to the 44th Annual C.J. Mackenzie Gala of Engineering Excellence, hosted by the University of Saskatchewan College of Engineering. Tonight, we'll be your MCs. My name is Jay Shaw, and I'm a third-year computer engineering student.
And my name is Maisha Nassim, a fourth-year electrical engineering student. As we gather here today, we acknowledge that we are on Treaty 6 territory and the homeland of the Métis. We pay our respect to our First Nation and Métis ancestors and reaffirm our relationship with one another. First, we would like to introduce the honored guests who are seated at the head table. Dr. Brad Polischuk, his wife, Lisa Stark, and their son, Tyson. Elder Roland Duquette and his wife, Sherry Bird. Mr. Eric Olison, MLA for Saskatoon University, who's representing the Minister of Advanced Education, Honorable Tina Baudry Miller. We also have His Worship Charlie Clark, the mayor of this great city. June Verhelst, civil engineering alumna and vice president of construction at Graham. We also have multiple senior leaders of our university, including President Peter Stoichev, Provost and VP Academic, Dr. Tony Vanelli, Deborah Posega Osborne, Vice President of University Relations, Dean of College of Engineering, Dr. Suzanne Cresta, our Engineering Associate Dean Academic, Dr. Bruce Sparling, Associate Dean Research, Dr. Terry Fonstad, and finally, Head of our Department, Electrical and Computer Engineering, Dr. Robert Johansson.
We also have five past C.J. Mackenzie Distinguished Lecturers with us tonight, which is a new record. We have Dennis Johnson, Russ Renberg, Gil Ledresse, Marvin Romano, and Mike Marsh. And now, let's find out a little bit about the rest of you. Who traveled at least 2 hours to be here tonight? A few of you. Who traveled at least 4 hours to be here tonight? I know that the distinguished lecturer did. And who never left last year's event? To the person who kept your hand up, sir, I admire your passion. The agenda for tonight will first be a little bit of background knowledge on engineering and this event, then remarks from our honorable guests, followed by dinner, and then our keynote presentation by distinguished lecturer Dr. Brad Polischuk. And closing the evening will be a gift presentation from host department, electrical and computer engineering. We are all here tonight at this Gala of Engineering Excellence because engineering means something to us. Whether it's because of the job we have or our interest in learning about the things around us. Tonight, we celebrate a profession that has an impact on literally everything around the world. So we would like to welcome all the industry leaders, alumni, faculty, dignitaries, and friends of the College of Engineering, as well as the 300 undergraduate and graduate students with us this evening. Everyone here is a member of our thorough family.
The C.J. Mackenzie Gala of Engineering Excellence has a rich and vibrant history within the College of Engineering, University of Saskatchewan. In 1976, Dr. Mel Hussein, who is here in the audience with us today, and Dr. Joe Chudobiak, started an annual Distinguished Graduate Lecture Series in the College of Engineering. The event was to honor alumni who have reached a special level of achievement in the engineering profession. Chalmers Jack, or C.J. Mackenzie, was the first Dean of College of Engineering, University of Saskatchewan. In addition to being the first Dean of our college, Dr. Mackenzie is known for designing and building Saskatoon's unique Broadway Bridge. His career involved working with scientists, engineers, administrators, students, and also politicians. After leaving the college in 1939, he worked as a leader in developing nuclear research in Canada and became the president of National Research Council in 1944. In 1984, when C.J. Mackenzie passed away, the college adopted this, the dress code, which is the Mackenzie dress tartan, as its own, as you can see by the scarf and tie we are wearing here tonight. By wearing this tartan, we honor the legacy that Dr. Mackenzie has left with our college and engineering profession as a whole. The C.J. Mackenzie Gala is about engineering excellence and all who contribute to it, from C.J. Mackenzie himself to our distinguished lecturer and you here in the audience today. Now let's kickstart the program by hearing from the president of the university, Dr. Peter Stoichev, to bring greetings on behalf of our university.
Well, welcome everyone, and thank you very much, Jay and Mesha, and a particular welcome to all the students who are here tonight. I really appreciate being invited to this gala. It is, I think, the greatest college event at a university that has 17 colleges and schools, so that's really saying something. It's got a rich tradition, and I love the title that has the word excellence in it. And that's what this is all about and what this wonderful college is all about. I want to give thanks to Elder Roland Duquette, who is here and sitting at the table with my wife Catherine and our dean and I and our distinguished guest and his family. And Roland has sat through many, many convocation ceremonies, helping us be the best place we can possibly be for and with Indigenous people, students, and their communities. Thank you very much, Roland, for being here. His Worship Charlie Clark, who is, among many other things, as a great mayor of this city, a huge supporter of innovation in this city, and we'll be seeing more and more examples of that tonight and as time goes by here. Thank you very much, Your Worship, for being here. And MLA Erica Lawson, who is an enormous supporter of this university as well. And for those of you who have the time to do so, take a look at the province's plan for growth 2.0, as I call it, that has a lot to say about the role that a research-intensive university with a very strong College of Engineering can play in the development of this province. I thank also the Engineering Advancement Trustees who do so much for the college. And I want to acknowledge our distinguished guest tonight, Dr. Brad Polischuk, and his wife, Lisa Stark, and their son, Tyson, who tells me that he, as a graduating high school student this year, intends to come to the U of S as an engineering student from Delaware. So thank you very much, Tyson. It's wonderful to have you here. The three, the five, the four, I think I was hearing one isn't here actually tonight, C.J. Mackenzie distinguished lecturers who are in the audience. And thank you also to so many of the organizers for this event. For this event to be on this scale and so wonderfully done, there are many organizers who I'm sure will be thanked at some point this evening. But I want to be the first at least to thank them en masse. Dean Suzanne Cresta, we're very lucky to have her here and to be an admirable leader of this great college as well. Thank you very much for all the work that you do. And to the industry representatives who are here tonight as well and who are, by virtue of your presence here and for all you do in the other 364 days of the year before you come back here again, all you do to support engineering, innovation, and this college, thank you very much for being here as well. And all of the sponsors, including Graham Construction, who has been an inspired presence at this university for many, many years. Deborah Patsig-Osborne, thank you very much for being here, our VP University Relations, Daniel Dunbar, our AVP of Development. And there's a great crew of people, faculty, students, staff, administrators from the College of Engineering who helped to make it a great organization. We are a U15 university. There are 96 universities in this country. Only 15 of them are part of a group of research-intensive medical doctoral universities. It's an extremely distinguished group to be a member of. And I tell people on as many occasions as possible that we could not be a member of that group if we did not have a strong College of Engineering with a strong research tradition and a spectacular future in front of it in terms of research and the wonderful quality of students that it graduates. And I say every chance I get, and always at convocation to, in total, many thousands of people a year, that I always hear about the hireability and the extraordinary value of the students who graduate from this college in particular, from employers who are looking to hire them. It's a priority for me at the U of S to support the College of Engineering and to support the dean's and the provost's intentions to see the student numbers here grow exponentially, and to leverage the college's role in the local and national innovation agenda. The theme that'll be the hallmark of my second term as a president here is innovation. And that will help to ensure that we are indeed, as you see before you, the university that the world needs. This isn't a boast, but it's a commitment to be outward facing, to be thinking about all the ways in which we can help the world meet the major challenges that it faces today. And again, we could not do that without a really excellent College of Engineering. This gala was built on the tradition of gathering faculty, students, staff, alumni, and associated industries to celebrate achievements in engineering. And an example, what we'll hear more about tonight, is Dr. Polischuk's work to advance medical imaging technology, research that started here at the University of Saskatchewan with Dr. Kassup, and has had enormous impact, helping medical professionals give patients the information they need to make critical decisions about their health care. The spirit of C.J. Mackenzie is here as well. I appreciate what our student MC said about him, and I'll just add a little bit to that. He has been described, and he came from here, as the single most important figure in the post-war growth of Canadian science. The single most important figure in the post-war growth of Canadian science. No other university is saying that about its first dean of engineering. He did research in alkali-resistant concrete design, and he was involved in the design and construction in a very critical way, and supervision of the Broadway Bridge. There's much to say about that. I won't take your time to do it, but it's a fascinating history. He was the acting president of the NRC. He was appointed by Andrew McNaughton, who was from Moosomin, Saskatchewan. And C.J. Mackenzie became the government's chief scientist in World War II and the main scientist planning C.D. Howe's science policy. He had an extraordinary influence on the history of this country and on the history of science and innovation and engineering in this country. Under him, the National Research Council expanded tenfold. He was the president of Atomic Energy Canada and the chair of its control board. With NRC President Stacey, in 1952, he laid the foundations of Canada's modern scientific system, and he helped to bring Gerhard Hertzberg, who is a professor here in physics, to Ottawa. Students, I'm particularly directing these remarks at you, just because you should be proud of the fact, as we all are, that C.J. Mackenzie had such a formidable role on the formation of this country in the 20th century. These were times when Canada was a world leader in areas of science. Gerhard Hertzberg, who went on to win the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1970, is one example of that, and he won the first scientific Nobel Prize that was awarded to a Canadian. He was a world leader in public policy, in radar, in nuclear energy research, and in innovation. And if C.J. Mackenzie were here today, I'm sure he would agree that the foundation of a nation's innovation infrastructure is its pool of scientists and engineers. And so students, as you begin to formulate your career aspirations, consider C.J. Mackenzie, after whom this gala is named, and the crucial role engineering will play in the province's and the country's innovation agenda. So to Suzanne Cresta, Dean of this college, all the leaders here tonight, and all of our distinguished guests, sponsors, students, faculty, and staff, thank you so very, very much for allowing me to offer these remarks, and please enjoy the wonderful evening ahead.
Thank you, President Stoichev. This year, the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering has the privilege of hosting C.J. Mackenzie. The history of the university and computing includes many notable events, one of which happened in 1957, when the U of S became one of the first universities to buy a computer. It was this exact model. And to give you an idea of how long ago that really is, let me compare the technology of computers at that time to today. So in 1957, computers didn't even have a monitor. They just had buttons. Today, we don't only have a monitor, or maybe multiple, but they can also store thousands of gigabytes of data. In 1957, the computer that was bought by the U of S stored 3.8 times 10 to the power of negative 6 gigabytes. So that's 16 million times less than your cell phone. Today's computers also have billions of transistors. In 1957, it had vacuum tubes and a circuit which you could simulate with just 60 transistors. Not 60 million, just 60, 60. I know because I counted all of them. The computer also weighed a ton, literally half a metric ton. But the funny part is, looking back at the advertising for it, it was marketed as a small, portable computer because it was, quote, smaller than a desk. And it was also, quote, advertised as low cost because it cost $47,000. That's over $430,000 in today's money. You could buy a Ferrari for that. U of S, I think you made a mistake. Who needs an education when you can just get a Ferrari instead? Dean Cresta, don't worry, I'm just joking. That's why we're here. We chose to get our USASC engineering degrees so we can earn our Ferraris later.
As you can probably expect, an event of this magnitude could not have happened without the generous support of our industry partners. Please join me in thanking all the sponsors of this event, including the title sponsor, Graham Construction, gold sponsor, Co-op Refinery Complex, and Victory Majors Corporation. And finally, silver sponsors, ASL Paving, AODBT Architecture and Interior Design, and ARC Resources. Our title sponsor, Graham Construction, has been a long-standing supporter of this event. Please join me in welcoming June Verhelst, the Vice President of Construction from Graham Construction.
Good evening. On behalf of Graham Group, we wish to congratulate Dr. Brad Polischuk with his appointment as the Distinguished Lecturer tonight. We can't wait to hear his innovations and his accomplishments. We very much look forward to the C.J. Mackenzie Gala every year. As you know, Graham was built on the strength and character and innovation of U of S graduates and U of S engineering graduates, and so We're very pleased to be here with government, industry, alumni, and all the elements of that churn the economy. And we know that U of S engineers impact the regional economy, the province, and federal and global. And we see the impact when we see the distinguished lecturers come back year after year. We're blown away by the product that the College of Engineering produced. We are very pleased with the strategies and the commitment from the College of Engineering in embracing indigenization and diversification and the continued quest to go forward with classes and designations that are future-looking and new ways to learn. And the embracing of industry is really a key part of the college's success. So we want to congratulate Dr. Cresta and her team on their 44th C.J. Mackenzie Gala. Thank you.
Thank you, June. Next, we have someone who has been recognized with a number of national and international awards for her research, training, and leadership. She is someone known for putting the training of the next generation of engineers as a top priority. She is the co-editor of Handbook of Industrial Mixing and chief editor of Advances in Industrial Mixing. Please help me in welcoming the Dean of the College of Engineering, Dr. Suzanne Cresta.
Well, good evening and a warm, warm welcome from our leadership team. This is always such a special event, and we're just delighted to have everybody here. We're here to celebrate primarily our distinguished lecturer, but also the College of Engineering, its students, faculty, staff, and all of our alumni. So welcome to all of you. Thank you, President Stoiche, for joining us this evening. It's wonderful to hear again and to hear more about your vision for the university, specifically around the role of U15 universities in the innovation economy and the role that postgraduate education plays in that. I don't think we can stress that enough. The challenges we face today are complex. They require both the strong foundations of engineering undergraduate degrees and the more specialized skills and close mentoring which come with our master's and doctoral training. I think many of you know that one of the reasons I came to this college and this university was the value it places on tradition and a strong sense of community. The Thoreau family shares a commitment to our college, to the deeply held values of our profession, and turns those two things into friendships that can really last a lifetime. This network of colleagues makes foundational contributions to our provincial economy and in solving problems that meet the needs of our world, however small or extended that world might be for each of us. A critical part of the success of our undergraduate programs, which June Verhulst talked about, is the Engineering Advancement Trust. Since it was founded in 1986, the EAT has donated more than $3.5 million to the college, helping it to provide innovative programming and modern facilities for our students. As we entered the first year redesign project last year, the EAT stepped up immediately to commit over $300,000 for development of online learning materials and development of new assessment methods. As the dean, I can tell you that means an incredible amount. The validation from our community says that we're on the right track and we should carry on. When this program rolls out in 2021, it will transform the way we deliver first-year engineering, updating the program to include all of the basic sciences adding modules on safety, communication, peer-to-peer learning, and reducing the time we spend repeating material covered in high school while staying focused on the concepts which are essential to our second-year programs. We are very excited about the opportunities this is opening up and the modernization of our design for learning, the learning our students need in order to succeed. This year, the EAT established an award to honor those who contributed their time and talent to the early and ongoing success of the EAT Fund. This past fall, the Engineering Advancement Trust Alumni Service Awards were presented to alumni B.J. Seaman and Al Schreiner, and posthumously to Dean Peter Nikiforuk and alumnus Art Dumont. All of them were indispensable during the EAT's early years, and I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the current members of the EAT whose hard work today brings immeasurable benefit to our students and the college. Much like the alumni who began the EAT, I am beyond proud of our current students who are working to make history within the college and on this campus by starting the University of Saskatchewan Engineering Students Fund, also known by its shorter but somewhat awkward acronym, USESF. This student-backed initiative puts students in the driver's seat, substantially increasing the financial support available for engineering students who have opportunities to attend conferences, professional development courses, fund additional academic resources, or increase the capital available for our student associations, societies, and particularly our student design teams, who have become extremely competitive in global competitions and who want to take their work even further. All of our students will be voting on this fund in the middle of February, and I'm so proud of all of you for making this commitment and for identifying an opportunity like this, as are our alumni. Members of the engineering class of 1979 have already promised $3,000 to help kickstart the fund. Similar funds to the USESF at other universities have seen students provide substantial funding for dedicated facilities and makerspaces for student design teams and makerspaces. I am elated to see this next piece of history unfold for our students, and I look forward to seeing the growth and opportunities that initiatives like the USESF can provide. So thank you to the students that are leading that. I think that I can tell you that it has the absolute unconditional support of the entire university, and the vision that this represents is really important for the future of all of you. In addition to President Stoichev and his wife Catherine, I'm delighted to welcome Deborah Pazega Osborne, our Vice President, University Relations. Provost Vanelli was looking forward to the event, but emailed me last night that they had a sudden thing come up that they wouldn't be able to make it. He sends his greetings and best wishes, as do Kay and Dora Nasser. We treasure the support of all of these pillars of our community, including Mayor Charlie Clark, our elder, and our MLA, Eric Olofsson, who really contribute an enormous amount to the university community. We love to welcome you to our table. We love to introduce you to our friends, and we share the stories and accomplishments that excite us tonight. We hope that you find the same joy in them as we do. Thanks to our sponsors who make this evening possible. Graham Construction is this year's presenting sponsor. Thank you as well to our gold sponsors, the Co-op Refinery, Victory Majors, and our silver sponsors, AODBT, ASL Paving, and ARC Resources. It warms my heart always to see so many USASC Engineering alumni here this evening. 2 years ago, I don't think I knew any of you, and tonight I feel very much at home. So thank you for the warm welcome to Saskatoon, and thank you for continuously engaging with our college. With the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering hosting the gala this year, we're happy to be joined by one of that department's most distinguished alumni. Roy Billington earned his PhD at the University of Saskatchewan and was recruited to be an assistant professor here in 1964. We are so fortunate that he and his wife Joyce chose the University of Saskatchewan, where Roy had what can only be described as a remarkable career. It seems that he did it all, methodically, in order. He created and led the Power Systems Research Group, which he still participates in today. Over the course of his career, he supervised more than 135 graduate students and published nearly 1,000 technical papers at a time when a single journal might contain 10 papers in a year. He served as department head, associate dean, and acting dean of the college. My team tells me this was not all at the same time, however. Roy recently received a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers Power and Energy Society for his pioneering work on power systems reliability engineering. Most of us didn't even know that might be important until the late 90s. So I can tell you that that was really leading edge work that had a huge impact down the road. Thank you, Roy, for all you've done and continue to do for the college. I'm thrilled that our students have the opportunity to spend time with you and with all the other alumni who have made the time to join us here tonight. A warm welcome to our students, and I'd like to know how many of you are here for the first time. Excellent. We're thrilled to have you here. We hope that this evening gives you some insight into what lies on the other side of your degree. All the hard work is definitely worth it. Finally, I'd like to give a special shout out to the 2020 Western Engineering Competition Committee. How many, could you just raise your hands if you actually managed to get away and be here with us tonight? Oh, excellent. A couple of people. They're hosting this major Western Canadian event in Saskatoon later this week. Good luck and best wishes for an excellent event. This gala is a time where we pause to celebrate one of our distinguished alumni. And this year, we're excited to welcome Brad Polischuk as our distinguished lecturer, representing the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering. As Vice President of Research and Development for Hologic, a medical technology company focused on women's health, his career is an example of how an engineering degree and the continuation to a graduate education can be a springboard to remarkable achievement. I asked Brad earlier today what made him decide to go to graduate school, and he said, I was just so inspired by the way Safa Kassab taught his courses, and I wanted to spend more time learning about it. And I think that for many of us who spend lives as academics, that one professor, that one moment where you just get so excited about the discipline that you want to learn everything is a really important moment. And so that's a special thing, and I really want to acknowledge the importance of creating those spaces for people to live in. His career is an his work bridges multiple disciplines: materials science, electrical engineering, medical imaging and diagnostics, and instrumentation. Anyone who has ever tried to learn a second language knows something of the frustration and challenge of staying at the table when your basic assumptions are being challenged, none of the vocabulary being used is familiar, and everything feels very confronting. This is the nature of multidisciplinary work, and the challenges we face when trying to operate in this environment are myriad. Engineers are creative problem solvers. We're used to working in large engineering teams where communication is specific, very focused, and extremely precise. This allows us to build bridges and buildings with teams of 2,000 people or more and end up with the desired outcome. Nothing falls down. When confronted with a particularly large or complex problem, we're also learning the importance of stepping outside our discipline and even our field of study to find broadly based and resilient solutions. This is not always easy because we move from being extremely fluid in a team that all speak the same precise functional language, to dealing with disciplines that may express their lack of fluency with math or physics as if it were a badge of honor. We instinctively fear this will jeopardize the safety of the public we are sworn to serve and protect, and it can be difficult to remain calm until we can understand the other kinds of expertise these disciplines bring to the table. Once we begin to understand that, as engineers, we also have some hidden assumptions which trample on aspects of other people's core values and identity. The chasm between our disciplines becomes a gap, and the other can become a valued colleague and a friend. I want to applaud everyone in the room who has had the courage to stick with the journey to multidisciplinary collaborations and teams. I still find that I have the capacity to startle when confronted with a particularly difficult position. Sometimes a couple of breaths gives enough space to find the next step. Sometimes a remarkable facilitator can find the bits of flexibility we need to keep going. And sometimes I just need to walk away and regroup to come back the next day. That's okay. The important thing is to stay at the table and to keep talking. Keep engaging, keep being curious, keep focusing on a shared commitment. That's the path forward every single time. I'm very much looking forward to hearing more of Brad's story. First, I want to share three examples of remarkable multidisciplinary work going on in our college, one in groundbreaking research, one in transformative curriculum design, and one in indigenization. Daniel Chen, who is with us tonight, earned his PhD in mechanical engineering at the University of Saskatchewan and is now one of the leading researchers in our division of biomedical engineering. His research focuses on tissue engineering, which is creating three-dimensional scaffolds to help repair tissues and organs. Daniel formed the Tissue Engineering Research Group, which draws researchers from the College of Medicine, the College of Veterinary Medicine, the Canadian Light Source, and the College of Engineering. Some human tissue is very slow to heal and cannot be easily grafted as we have learned to do with skin. Starting from the idea that the healing would be much faster if we could provide a friendly scaffold to support cell growth, and then adding to this the idea that starting the growth of cells from the patient on that scaffold before implanting it in the body would reduce the chances of rejection, tissue engineering entered a new era. In collaboration with a professor in the College of Medicine, Daniel and his students have explored ways to accelerate the healing of peripheral nerves and are now applying this new knowledge to spinal cord repairs. He later worked with researchers interested in the repair of cartilage and teeth. Others are investigating repairing heart tissue after a heart attack. This is exciting, leading-edge work that is important not only to our province, but to the world. In this case, it's the intimate world of a patient whose family is dealing with the after effects of a serious injury. It is also a benefit derived by the global community of healthcare. So when we talk about the university the world needs, we mean many different worlds. Whatever the world is for you today, we are impacting those things on many scales and in many different ways. To many of us, this work in tissue engineering is astounding, and it may also seem light years away from where you stand this evening if you are currently an undergraduate student. It's important for all of you to remember that as you earn your degree, you're building the same engineering, team building, and communication skills that Dr. Chen has needed to achieve success with his team. Whether it's capstone design, a group project in first or second year, or being a team member on one of our extracurricular design teams, You are learning how to work with diverse team members, people who bring different backgrounds and experiences to the table. Professor Sean Ma, our college's Jerry G. Huff Chair in Innovative Teaching, is leading a second multidisciplinary project that bridges across campus. The first year redesign project, which started as an inquiry into whether we were actually teaching what our students needed to learn, has expanded into a visionary and highly collaborative process involving the College of Arts and Science along with the College of Engineering. On many campuses, those two colleges struggle to work together. There have certainly been some cultural challenges to overcome in this process, some policies that proved extraordinarily difficult, and some new tools and processes we needed to put into place. One of the success stories that is just emerging is the suite of four natural science modules that will be taken by all students: geology, biology, chemistry, and physics. These courses will focus on a single case study, a complex multidisciplinary problem. Our first case study is climate change. Biology will probe the concepts and impacts of biodiversity. Geology will provide insight into geologic timescales and change. Physics will look at the impact of black body radiation. And chemistry will look at different gases in miniature greenhouses and their impact on temperature and plant respiration. Taking all of these together, our first-year students will return to their engineering design module to consider how these changes impact the decisions we make, the teams we need to build, and the design elements we need to prioritize as engineers. So it's a very, very different way of teaching first-year engineering. It's a very inclusive approach, and it takes many perspectives in a very serious way. My final example concerns the work we're doing to bring Indigenous perspectives, worldviews, and knowledge into our curriculum. Several of our faculty members and staff, specifically Matt Dunn, Sean Ma, and Sarah Gauthier, have been involved in an ancestral technology grant from Promo Science. One of the outcomes of that work is the analysis of the travois, a frame made out of long sticks used by First Nations people to carry heavy loads over land. In our summer orientation for Indigenous students on campus in STEM disciplines, students consider why this useful tool was important and follow it up by exploring what happens if you modify the design, what changes to the loads that you can carry. This strengthens identity and confidence and helps our students look with new eyes into different traditions and new ways of knowing. The bottom line is that when diverse teams work together towards a common goal, we can achieve solutions that are robust to change and that meet the needs of the broader community we serve. Along with the critical thinking, creativity, team building, and problem solving skills that an engineering education has always provided, as President Stoichev mentioned earlier, we now critically need the ability to reach across disciplinary boundaries into communities and bridge varied perspective to find shared purpose and understanding for meaningful innovation for the future. My thanks to our many faculty members who take on this important work each day and who are here joining us in this important celebration for the college. In closing, I want to thank our staff for all of the work that has been done to put this event together. And in particular, I want to thank Carlene Deutscher and the rest of our external relations team, and the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering, who are our hosts this year. It has been really lovely welcoming Brad to the college earlier today, and I'm delighted that his family is able to join us tonight to share the event. Thanks to all of you for joining us to honor him and all he's done to make our Thoreau family proud. Have a wonderful, wonderful evening.
Thank you, Dr. Cresta. Before we start this evening's dinner service, I would like to welcome Elder Roland Duquette. Before he takes the stage, I would like to recognize the utmost respect we have for our elders and knowledge keepers. Elder Duquette is a member of the Miss First Nation. He's a survivor of residential school, an active runner, and a talented dancer. It is customary to offer tobacco to an elder as a symbol of gratitude and thankfulness for the knowledge that they share with us. Tobacco is a sacred gift that allows prayers and blessings to be carried to everyone's respected creator. In this gesture, tobacco is passed from the left hand to elder's left hand while shaking the right hand. This symbolizes that when hands and gifts join, it forms the Métis infinity symbol, but also shows that tobacco is a gift directly from heart. So as we gather here to celebrate engineering, we would like to formally invite Elder Roland Duquette to the stage with this offering of tobacco and express our sincere gratitude for his blessing.
Hi. Tama ka kio ga tam skat na o tan taski na ki pita gutik. Ina nas kum we ani stay we kum ga we an. Kape we tapum ta guk. Yoga mina ka we chmi chum ta guk. Nista egi che taman ni hiawun ni ni hiyo. Ina nas kum we an mana kan tum ga we an ka pik sku an pik skun. Nista wa me gi mi kusian. Kapachitan, kachumuyan, kagagi sumuyan. Nista, katawan piksquan, magi gwe note kiaskin, women agi gwe note mam scotin, awea kakwim steak, mistake ate game suyan near. Iktamaga eightian, omatweka piksquan. Iktamaga eightian is the mwim steak skate masuyan, maga. Kapati gawe anek te tapate muan tapate monim im stage te in taskina. Good evening, everyone. As I was introduced, the elder here, I'm very honored and humbled to be in your presence. For me, it's an honor when we were offered tobacco. How much more can we ask? Because it's a protocol. It's an opening for us to share our identity, our culture, our language, how we do things in a very spiritual way, how we teach our children the morals through storytelling, through activities that are still in use. Being 75 years old, I still run every day or every chance I get. And I say that with honesty that I have to apply that to be a resource, a role model, a mentor for my grandkids and my children. And I think how much more can I lower myself and be that person that to leave a legacy for my grandkids, which I love dearly. So very shortly here, I'm just going to, again reaffirm my, gratitude to be thankful for the people that I've met in my walk. Like the table here, Peter, is one of my, friends. I've committed that way, and Charlie, and other ones I cannot name because it's... I don't know most of them, but when I shake hands with a friend, they are my friends as well. So that's how we try to interact our identity. A gentleman the other day said to me, "Mr. Duquette, I hate the snow." I said, "Oh, okay." Why is it that you hate it? What is it about the snow that you hate? Well, he said, it's in a way, and you know, it's too cold. And I just don't like it, he said, you know. If I can move south, I would, he said. But we're stuck here, I told him, you know. We're stuck here in the Saskatchewan weather, I said. I'll tell you a little story about snow. When I was growing up as a child, the first fall of snow, my mother would take us out in the snow, you know. We'd gather it in a bowl without, you know, or with bare feet, no shoes on, no socks, no headgear, nothing. And we'd stand there collecting that snow in that container. Then my mother would say, bring it into the house now. We'd put it over the stove, you know, in a bigger bowl. And then she would say, this is our Creator's water. This is what's going to happen when we is going to be dumping more on the land. And this is our blanket. What's underneath, it's going to go to sleep. What's underneath, nothing is going to disturb it. Because this is like a blanket when you go to bed. It insulates you from the cold. And underneath that blanket of snow, those little, you know, plants, you know, berries, whatever, they're germinating. They're moving like that, back and forth. They're barely moving, but they're alive. They never die, she said. And then when we address the snow as being a problem, we are the problem because we're not satisfied. We want more. We want to change the weather if we could. That's not our way. Creator is the one that has that control. And then when the snow comes, when the springtime comes, it starts getting warmer. And then the plants, they need that water. So the water sinks to the bottom. And then they start drinking that water. Finally, they wake up feeling good. You know, they stretch out as a plant coming out of the ground. That's what she talked about, was the how much alive are we, even if we think we're just about dying. There's something greater that's going to bring us up. Like the students here, I was mentioned. You are the ones that germinating at the bottom of that blanket. And the engineers, the ones that have gone on, you know, have been and still are, you know, the professors, whatever, they are the ones, are the blanket. They are the ones nurturing you to be that person who you are. That's something engineering cannot, you know, put a different label on, but you are the ones that are going to be coming up as the people. Eh? The people are going to be coming up to be the ones that are going to keep that walk going. So that was my message tonight, and hopefully that gives you a little thought of being human. Eh? Feel yourself here. Sometimes this one here takes over too much, eh? But here, feel that Mother Earth, eh? Because I am Canada. I am the land. So are you. And welcome to Canada, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Elder Duquette. We would like to encourage you to share your time here with others via social media using hashtag CJM2020. Now, if you don't know what a hashtag is, feel free to talk to the Gen Z of your group. If you look at the center of your table, you'll see some centerpieces which are inspired by our distinguished lecturer, our host department of electrical and computer engineering, and the new USASC commitment and goal to be what the world needs. It's on either side. We invite you to talk with other tables during breaks in this evening's program to see all the centerpieces. Inside some of the vases, you'll see wires and circuit boards, which represent electrical and computer engineering. In others, there's a pink ribbon paying tribute to the difference our lecturer, Dr. Brad Polischuk, has made in the detection and diagnosis of breast cancer. Ultimately, because of our engineering education, we will go on to do what Dr. Polischuk has done, be the difference the world needs. The metal circle represents the engineering iron ring, and a reminder that within each of us, we all have the courageous curiosity to live up to the principles of the University of Saskatchewan and be the engineer the world needs.
Now it's time to begin this evening's dinner service. Just a couple of reminders. It will be a served plated meal prepared by the head chef at Prairieland Park. Feel free to remain seated during dinner and converse with your fellow table mates. For those who have dietary restrictions and allergies, you can alert your server at this time. There is also a card at your table for a complimentary bottle of wine. Additional bottles can be purchased at the bar. After dinner, we will proceed with the remaining portion of this evening's featuring our keynote speaker. Thank you. Thank you. Hello, everyone. Please take your seats so we can begin the next part of this evening. Firstly, we would like to thank the chef, kitchen staff, and servers of Prairieland Park for this exquisite meal and service tonight. Please join me in giving a huge round of applause.
Now, let's get to why we're here. Dr. Brad Polischuk. Brad Polischuk earned his bachelor's degree in electrical engineering in 1988, master's in 1990, and PhD in 1993, all from the University of Saskatchewan. His supervisor was Professor Safa Kassap, who's still a professor with the U of S and is sitting with us today. Dr. Polischuk's work is in the area of mammography, which is X-ray imaging for detection and diagnosis of breast cancer. Brad's thesis and research was the first time that electrical properties needed to make good selenium for a detector were measured. The research from that time and later while he was working for medical technology companies changed the design of mammographic X-ray detectors throughout the world. Brad has 7 patents and more than 20 published research papers. He has served as a referee and editor for IEEE, the International Institute for Electrical and Electronics Engineers. After completing a PhD, Brad joined Naranda Advanced Materials, which later became ANRAD, then transferred to parent company Analogic. Today, Brad is the Vice President of Research and Development for Hologic, a medical technology company. Hologic is a company with a $14 billion market cap and employs over 6,000 people. During his time at ANRAD, and based on his MSc and PhD research, Brad and the team at ANRAD developed commercial detectors that contain selenium. With these selenium detectors, it increased the resolution of mammography, leading to a better detection rate for breast cancer. Ultimately, because of Brad's research and work, he has made a transformational impact in the lives of breast cancer patients, as his work has either directly or indirectly contributed to most X-rays used for mammography today.
In the preparation for introducing Brad, we had the opportunity to hear about Brad's achievement from Professor Safa Kassap. Brad and Dr. Kassap have kept in touch for over 3 decades now. And during this short meeting with Professor Kassap, it was very clear how immensely proud he was of Brad. Quoting Professor Kassap directly here, Brad was ambitious, visionary, and a little stubborn. He came in every working day, 8:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. I never had a student who worked as hard or is as disciplined or persevering as Brad. As we gather for the 44th C.J. Mackenzie Gala, we are here to celebrate our profession and Dr. Paul Shuck's leadership and hard work. He is the only distinguished lecturer to earn a bachelor's, master's, and PhD, all from College of Engineering, University of Saskatchewan. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Brad Polischuk to the stage to share his history of engineering excellence.
Thank you very much for that wonderful introduction. It's a tremendous honor to be here tonight. Thank you to the College of Engineering for hosting such a fabulous event, one that's so rich in tradition. It's terrific to be back here at the University of Saskatchewan and see so many familiar faces. I'd like to acknowledge some of our many distinguished guests here tonight. The Honorable Charlie Clark, the Mayor of Saskatoon, Dr. Peter Stoichev, the President of the University of Saskatchewan, and Dr. Suzanne Cresta, the Dean of the College of Engineering. And a special thank you to Carlene Deutscher, the events coordinator, for organizing this gala. Carlene, it's been absolutely wonderful working with you and your team preparing for this evening. I'm extremely grateful to have many friends and family with me here tonight. My wife, Lisa, and my son, Tyson, to name a few. Lisa is a highly successful in her own right. She's a corporate attorney in one of the bigger law firms in the United States. But despite her being a lawyer, I love her anyways. She's my pillar of strength, my best friend, and she's always there for me. She's also the only person that I know that actually appreciates my sense of humor. Tyson is a senior in high school, just starting to figure out what's in store for him in the next phase of his life. Perhaps with a small nudge from me and a little luck, he will decide to pursue a career in engineering. However, Tyson, if you decide on a different path, I want you to know that's also okay with me, because I get it. It's not cool to be like your old man. Thank you to all the alumni, faculty, and staff who have gathered here tonight as well. And finally, a very warm, special welcome to all the engineering students who have taken time out of your busy study schedules to share this evening with us. I recall being in your shoes more than 35 years ago, an idealist, eager to make a difference in this world, yet not quite sure how to make the biggest impact. So tonight, I would like to share with you 10 valuable lessons that I've learned throughout my career, which have really helped define who I am today. And I hope you'll find these lessons useful to yourselves as you embark on your own professional journeys. When I was a young student, the thought of pursuing a career in healthcare was the farthest thing from my mind. I was not interested in studying medicine, nursing, biology, or pharmacy. I didn't want to take care of sick people. Even as a kid, I always wanted to be an engineer and just build things. 35 years ago, if you asked me what I thought of the healthcare industry, my answer would have been very much like these cartoons. I would have said it's an industry stuck in the Stone Ages in many ways, heavily regulated, slow to adopt new technology, and extremely bureaucratic. None of this would have been inspiring to me as a young student wanting to make the difference. However, after spending 25 years in this industry, I humbly stand before you and admit I couldn't have been further from the truth. If you think of the challenges facing healthcare today, economic issues immediately come to mind. In the United States, roughly $1 in $5 that changes hands in the U.S. economy is spent in healthcare. That's about $3.5 trillion each and every year. In Canada, that ratio is somewhat smaller, roughly 1 in 10, but it's still a very sizable drain on your economic resources. With aging demographics and increases in life expectancy, that burden is only going to get worse for future generations unless something drastic is done. In the mid-90s, the concept called the Iron Triangle of healthcare was first introduced. The premise here is it's impossible to improve cost, quality, and access in healthcare simultaneously. If you benefit one area, the others will suffer. Now, I don't know about you, but I love it when people use terms like impossible. We're engineers. It's our job to make the impossible possible. That's why innovation is so wonderful. It offers the promise to completely disrupt this paradigm. Whether it's technological innovations with new therapies, drugs, and devices to improve outcomes and lower costs at the same time, or innovations in healthcare business models, or better healthcare delivery services. It's only through innovation that we'll be able to break this iron triangle and deliver quality, affordable healthcare to all for generations to come. The healthcare industry that I know today is one that needs to change, it's one that wants to change, and it's one that embraces change. It's an industry with a strong entrepreneurial spirit, one that pushes technological boundaries, and is quite frankly the complete opposite of my perceptions some 30 years ago. If I had listened to my inner voice back then, I would have completely missed the fabulous opportunity that I've had over the last quarter century. So my first lesson to all of you is this. If you want to make a difference, keep an open mind about where you're going to find the best opportunity that's right just for you. It's a very personal decision. You may need to try different industries along the way, and that's okay, because it's one of the most important decisions you'll make in your professional life. I found my home in the medtech area, specifically within the medical imaging community. I've had the great fortune to work on many different imaging modalities throughout my career and enjoyed all the unique challenges that they each offered. In all cases, I gravitated towards the front-end sensors of these systems, everything up to and including the analog-to-digital converter. This is where the proverbial rubber hits the road. This is where you need to understand how things work at the most fundamental level. Things like nuclear decay and radioactive isotopes, spinning protons in hydrogen nuclei, or X-ray interactions with electronic shells of atoms of different materials. Every modality has its own strengths and challenges. MRI imaging demands a huge 20-bit dynamic range, and this is what provides the fabulous soft tissue contrast that we've come to expect from modern MRI systems. In nuclear applications, you're actually imaging metabolic function rather than morphology. Here, energy and timing resolution are key sensor attributes for pinpointing the location of the isotope. X-ray applications continue to fight against electronic noise floors, as lower electronic noise means you can use lower amounts of radiation. Each modality is unique in its own way, but the methods for optimizing each remain the same. The one modality that remains closest to my heart, however, is digital mammo. In the case of mammography, the unique challenge here is resolution. Mammo is the highest resolution modality in use in medical imaging today. The reason you need such high resolution is for the detection of faint microcalcifications. Their shape, their size, and their distribution within the breast are all key signatures a radiologist is looking for when screening for breast cancer. These microcalcs can be as small as 50 microns in size, so the resolution of the imaging system is of critical importance. Now, I'd like to pause for a few seconds to say a few words about breast cancer and the prevalence of this terrible disease. It's the second most common form of cancer in women today. It's the second leading cause of cancer deaths overall, and is the number one for particularly young women. Each year in the United States, there will be 300,000 new women diagnosed with breast cancer, and we will lose 40,000 women each and every year to this disease. These are sobering statistics, to say the least. But the one that really resonates with me is that 1 in 8 women will suffer from this disease at some point in her life. Think about that as you look around the room tonight. 1 in 8 women will get breast cancer. Think about your family, your grandmother, your mother, your aunts, your wife, your daughters, and even your granddaughters. With 1 in 8 probability, it's easy to see why there are so few families that are untouched by this awful disease. There is some good news in the midst of this. Mortality rates are coming down. Through a combination of earlier detection, where prognosis is better, to innovations in therapies and treatments, we are winning this battle. Now, unknown to me at the time, my journey into breast imaging actually began here at the University of Saskatchewan. As an undergrad, I was first introduced to the field of solid-state physics, of all things, during a course taught by Dr. Safa Kassat. For those of you that have had the privilege to take his course, you will understand what I'm saying. He inspired me. He introduced the brand new world of semiconductors to me, and he explained things in such a clear and simple manner with so much excitement and enthusiasm that I immediately fell in love with the subject. I can honestly say it's because of you, Safa, that I pursued this as a career choice, and I'm eternally grateful to you for that. This only goes to show what a tremendous and everlasting impact that great teachers can have on us students. I want to personally thank you, Safa, and all of you wonderful faculty members for inspiring us students each and every day. You truly make a difference in our lives. After completing my undergrad, when the opportunity presented itself to pursue a graduate degree with Safa, I immediately knew that was my calling. Besides, a career in the fashion industry was not in the cards based on this photo. Learning as a graduate student is very different. During your undergrad, you have many assignments, quizzes, labs, lectures, and projects to keep you on track as you learn the tools of your trade. As a graduate student, you get to choose a subject with your supervisor, and you go off largely on your own to explore this new field. This was the first time in my life that I got to experience the joy of learning something just for the sake of learning. It was an adventure, with many right and wrong turns along the way. Of course, it helped to have a great mentor who was very patient with me when I went down the wrong path. It was by trying things and failing along the way that I learned that mistakes are an integral part of the learning process. So my second lesson to you is this. If you want to make a difference, learn to love learning. It's where you build a strong foundation. It's not just about getting to the right answer quickly, it's about the journey along the way. It's where you learn how to learn. It's where you develop skills that will serve you throughout your entire life. And it's a process that never ends. The subject of my graduate work was to look at the electrical properties of a semiconductor called selenium. Everybody knows about silicon as a semiconductor, but I confess, I didn't even know where selenium was on the periodic table when I began, but I trusted Safa that this would be an interesting material to study. He had a vision that one day, somehow, selenium could be used in medical imaging, but quite frankly, I had no idea how to turn that vision into a reality. We published many scientific papers during this time, studying the mechanical and electrical properties of selenium. It was basic fundamental research at its core, understanding science for the sake of understanding science. There were many of us that contributed to this work, both before and after my studies were completed. Towards the end of my graduate program, we were joined by a young man who did his postdoc with us. I knew him as a colleague and fellow student back then, but today you probably recognize him as Dr. Robert Johansson, head of the Electrical Engineering Department. It's a small world. After graduate studies, I entered the workforce to attempt to apply my newly acquired skills within industry. I started working for a materials company in the corporate research center with the goal of trying to make an imaging system using selenium as a semiconductor. We tried many different methods, but we failed. We failed miserably. We tried different readout technologies, like using toner-based development to laser-based readout to readout with electrostatic probes. We failed, and we failed again. We were spun off as an independent company. We were bought, and we were sold again. But during this tumultuous time, we persisted. We never gave up. It wasn't until many years later that the concept of using solid-state readout emerged. Entire industries and technologies needed to be born. The LCD industry did not exist in 1988, yet we needed technology like large-area TFT substrates for our vision to become a reality. High-density packaging technologies needed to be invented. Low-noise ASICs needed to be engineered. And of course, computational power needed to be improved by several orders of magnitude from 1988 to consider bringing this concept to reality. Fast forward to 2002, and the first commercial detectors based on this technology finally materialize. Starting with the TFT technology, producing a substrate with these small pixels challenged virtually every manufacturer in the LCD world. With leakage currents in the femtoamp range, we were pushing the technological limits of their processing capabilities. The selenium coating technology also evolved dramatically from the early days of the U of S. It evolved from a single layer to then two, and eventually ended up as 10 unique layers in the process. Performing defect-free coatings on these large area substrates remains a challenge even today. Traditional IC packaging in 1988 involved wire bonding a few leads of an IC into a plastic chip carrier. New innovations in high-density packaging were also required. Bump bonding ASICs onto special flexes with pitches so fine individual traces cannot be seen with the human eye, and using these COFs to make the more than 14,000 connections to the sensor, all new technology that needed development. Automation was key. Machines and processes to automatically align the COFs to the sensor and reliably make these interconnections, all of this needed to be invented. None of this existed back in 1988. And no fab like this would be complete without a great analytical team to perform failure analysis when things go disastrously wrong. And finally, we needed time for computer technology to evolve. With gigabytes of data generated at transmission speeds of several gigabits per second, this challenges even modern computers and networks found in hospitals today. Moore's Law definitely needed to catch up. Despite all these obstacles, the concept eventually came to reality, and several companies worldwide are now using it in the fight against breast cancer. When I travel the world and talk to customers, suppliers, and even competitors, and realize how many people have followed Dr. Kassap's original work many decades earlier, I'm extremely proud to be known as one of the original selenium junkies from the University of Saskatchewan. So my third lesson to you is this. If you want to make a difference, you need to dream big. Dream big and have the conviction to stay the course, even in the face of adversity. You will fail in your career. Failure is part of evolving. Do not listen to the naysayers who say things will never work. Persevere, and ultimately, you will prevail. There are two detector technologies that are in commercial use today in X-ray imaging, direct and indirect conversion detectors. Selenium directly absorbs the X-rays and converts them to charge. This charge is collected on the pixels underneath with minimal image degradation. Spatial resolution is limited only by the size of the collection pixels and not by the conversion process itself. Indirect detectors use a scintillator to absorb X-rays. The scintillator converts X-rays to light, and that light is collected on the substrate underneath using an array of photodiodes. Lateral spread of light in the scintillator leads to reduced sharpness of the image, almost independent of pixel size. As you can see from these side-by-side comparison images, the image from the selenium detector on the left is sharp and crisp. The image on the right is actually acquired from the state-of-the-art wafer-scale CMOS detector that was commercially introduced almost a decade after selenium hit the market. There is still no comparison in terms of sharpness. I'm extremely proud that selenium technology has withstood the test of time. It remains, even today, as the gold standard by which all others are measured against. The introduction of selenium technology in 2002 did not signal the end of innovation. Rather, it set off the beginning of a virtual arms race in the fight against breast cancer. After 2D imaging was introduced, next came 3D mammo, which allows the radiologist to remove superimposing tissue to get a better look to see if there's any missed lesions. This is one of those technological innovations I spoke earlier of in the Iron Triangle. It's been clinically proven to find more invasive cancers while simultaneously reduce the number of false positives and unnecessary procedures, providing both clinical and economic value to the healthcare system. Next came the introduction of minimally invasive image-guided surgeries and biopsies, enabled by high-performance detectors, providing better patient care and outcomes through more accurate procedures. Then came the notion of using contrast agents for spectral mammography. When used as a diagnostic tool, this may one day rival the performance of MRI for screening high-risk patients at a fraction of the cost of MRI, making it available and affordable technology for all. With each innovation, the performance of the detectors needed to be continually upgraded to meet the new challenges. Development never stops. Now, the new frontier is artificial intelligence. If you do some simple math, there's roughly 150,000 mammograms performed in the United States alone every day. If they're all performed on the state-of-the-art mammo machines, with each machine generating gigabytes of data per patient, you can quickly compute that's hundreds of terabytes of data generated every single day. And we're expecting humans to sift through this ocean of data to look for the presence of abnormalities. The idea of going to work and looking through terabytes of data sounds tremendously exhausting to me. Therefore, the notion of having computers look at the data is a very compelling story. The idea of using artificial intelligence in medical imaging is not a new concept. Long before AI became ubiquitous in our everyday lives, we were using machine learning algorithms and had commercial products based on these concepts as early as 2004, shortly after digital mammo began. Think about it. 2004. Google just went public as a company that year, yet the medical imaging community was already using these advanced concepts in clinical use. Now, I will confess that these early AI products had their limitations. They were based on rather simple neural networks and still relied heavily on software engineers to design algorithms to extract features and feed them back into these simple networks. And although they were beneficial to radiologists new to the trade, they were more of a nuisance to the more experienced ones. They pointed to areas already noted as suspicious, and they flagged many others that were not of concern at all. There were way too many false positives. Fast forward, and again, we benefit from increased available computer horsepower. Now, rather than simple networks, products today use deep convoluted neural networks and learn end-to-end without human intervention. With rich data sets for training, these new tools are demonstrating almost superhuman performance, both in terms of sensitivity and specificity. I just returned from the largest medical imaging trade show in the world this past December. In previous years, the established medical players and the big tech companies, the Amazons, the Googles, and the Microsofts of the world, were all there touting their advances in AI. However, this past year, the trade show organizers had to devote an entire new hall to accommodate all the new entrants to this field. The hall shown in these photos did not exist just 1 year ago. The proliferation of small and medium-sized companies trying to disrupt the medical imaging industry was like watching mushrooms spring up. They were everywhere. Seeing this, it was like watching disruption play out in real time just before my eyes. With the dawn of AI in healthcare, I noticed an interesting phenomenon about how people react to revolutionary change. At first, the software engineers were fearful when they realized that the computers could produce better results than they could. As the clinical performance of the AI tools improved, the radiologists expressed concern about the future of their profession. Anxiety was everywhere. Eventually, people learned to see this disruption for what it really was, just providing new tools to allow them to do their jobs better. For the radiologists, this means letting the computer do the heavy lifting in terms of data analysis to give them the freedom to focus on the more meaningful and difficult cases and to provide more patient-centric care. So my next lesson to all of you is this. If you want to make a difference, embrace change. Change is constant and inevitable. Adapt. Do not be afraid. Use innovation as a tool. It will make you a better you. About 8 years ago, I was attending an IEEE nuclear science symposium, and I heard about a new type of sensor that was being developed for high-energy physics applications. During my undergrad, we obviously learned about the workings of photodiodes and even learned about avalanche photodiodes, which can produce some modest gain. However, these new devices were like avalanche photodiodes on steroids, providing almost unlimited gain. I immediately knew that I wanted to play with them, really just out of curiosity. We got our hands on some early samples and brought them into our lab. I remember some of my colleagues even mocked me. They would say, "Well, there goes a vice president with a soldering iron. What could possibly go wrong here?" I didn't care. I was just excited to play with these novel devices. I was used to looking at individual X-ray photons, but X-rays have energy around 50,000 electron volts. Even then, you still need specialized electronics to accurately resolve them. With this new sensor, when I hooked it up to just a simple oscilloscope, I marveled at the fact that each blip on the scope represented a single light photon hitting the sensor. A single light photon with only 1 to 2 electron volts of energy. Almost 50,000 times smaller than the X-rays that I was used to detecting, yet I can see them with such a simple experimental setup. This was totally mind-blowing for me. Eventually, these devices have been incorporated in various medical imaging systems, along with other scientific and molecular diagnostic instruments. Only recently are they starting to appear in the consumer world, namely as sensors in LiDAR applications for autonomous vehicles and self-driving cars. Like AI, this is yet another example how the medical device world lives on the bleeding edge of technology, sometimes way ahead of the consumer world. The lesson to you is this. If you want to make a difference, stay curious throughout your career. Not everything you do needs to follow a grandmaster plan. So be a kid sometimes and just enjoy the process of exploring. You never know where it might lead. At one point in the late 90s, I decided to take a detour in my career. I spoke earlier of the value of trying different industries on for size, so I left healthcare to work in the fast-paced consumer electronics business. I managed to get a position with LSI Logic, a semiconductor chip design company that just won a design win with Sony to make a processor in the upcoming PlayStation 2 game console. This seemed exciting for me. It was a very high-profile product. I still believe it remains today as the best-selling game console of all time. And if you ask my son, he'd probably say it's the only important thing I've ever done in my career. We finally taped out the design in early January, and the fab was busy manufacturing wafers to ramp up production, when suddenly we got the dreaded call from Sony that they discovered a problem with the chip. In this world, product life cycles hinge around the desire to get products on the shelves in time for the Christmas shopping season. There is no time for mistakes. After learning about the reported problem, and even more concerning, the issue turned out to be in the part of the chip that I was responsible for. I was like a deer in the headlights, soon to be known around the world as the Scrooge who stole Christmas that year. Highly motivated, what ensued was many sleepless nights and weekends for myself and one of my colleagues to diagnose and ultimately fix the problem. In the end, we were successful, and the PlayStation 2 found its way under Christmas trees around the world that year. Ironically, we were even rewarded by LSI Logic for our efforts to fix the problem, the very problem that we were responsible for creating in the first place. And although we really appreciated the award, I was just happy not to get fired in the process. The lesson here is mistakes are inevitable. You will make them at various points in your career. It matters not that you make mistakes. What matters is how you react when you do. If you want to make a difference, own your mistakes. Admit to them, and then do everything in your power to make things right. Having previously worked in healthcare, there was always the notion that I was doing some good with my work. The voice was always present in the back of my head. But at no point in my life did I miss that voice more than when it was completely silent, working in the consumer space. Making toys and games was interesting and exciting, but it's not going to impact the world. I missed the higher calling that I felt when I was in healthcare, and once I realized this and how important it was for me, I returned to medical imaging and have not looked back since. Now, I've spoken a lot about technology tonight and the important role it will play in your career. However, it's the people you work with along the way that will make the most profound difference in your life. I've been fortunate to have many mentors, starting with SAFA in the early years, to people that nurtured me mid-career, and even now, I have people that continue to influence me in my career. Jay Stein, for example, is an engineering grad from MIT. He started Hologic back in the 80s, and he has since watched it grow to the diversified medtech company it is today, worth almost $15 billion. Now, Jay, at age 78, could easily have decided to sail off into the sunset and enjoy retirement. It's too boring for him. He could easily have remained as an executive within the company, CEO, CTO, chairman. He's been there, he's done that. He's since hired a capable executive management team to run the day-to-day operations of Hologic. Where Jay spends his time today is actually in the lab, working with engineers, doing product development. Engineering is his passion in life. And although there are days that I roll my eyes and I say, here comes Jay, what could possibly go wrong today? The truth is, it's inspiring to watch him work. His love of engineering is contagious, and he's a shining example of why we are so lucky to have chosen engineering as our profession. I've also had the privilege to serve as a mentor to some during my career. There have been a few key employees that I've hired that were truly unique. They were naive enough to think that they could accomplish anything, and they had an insatiable thirst for knowledge. My role was just to feed their young minds. At one point, something magical happened. With time, I realized that they became more knowledgeable about the subject than I was. The student became the teacher, and the teacher became the student. When this transformation happened, it was a very special feeling. Even today, we remain close and share a special bond. We also work with many young students, either as engineering interns or high school students or younger. Getting them hooked on science and engineering before they even begin to think about becoming lawyers. When I get to speak with these young people, I always tell them, we have the best job in the world. We get paid to solve puzzles and mysteries. And in every great mystery, there's a climax in the story, that instant of discovery, that eureka moment, when you finally make the breakthrough you've been searching for. In that moment, there are high fives shared amongst colleagues, there are fist pumps in the air if you're alone. That feeling never gets boring, and we as engineers get to experience it time and time again. The lesson in all these stories is if you want to make a difference, surround yourself with great people. No one is an island, and you'll only be as successful as the people around you. Cherish diversity in thought, in experience, in backgrounds, and in values. Thank those that have helped you along the way, and help those that are following in your footsteps. One special thing that we do in our office is we volunteer once or twice a year to help out in the community. Working with local charities, we identify special stories of people who need our support. It could be a breast cancer survivor, an elderly person unable to take care of their home, or even a handicapped veteran. We choose projects that are so easy to do, even we can't screw them up. Cleaning a yard, building a deck, painting a house, it doesn't really matter what the project is. It just matters we get out to help somebody in need. The reward for this is priceless. We get to have fun outside of work, enjoy each other's company, and finish the day enjoying a beer or two with the satisfaction of knowing we have done a small good deed to help out a total stranger. The phrase, giving is its own reward, is not just a slogan. It truly brings people together in ways that you cannot imagine. The simple lesson is this: If you want to make a difference, give back when and where you can. It does not matter whether it's large or small. Just give for the sake of giving. And finally, October is an important month for us. It's Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Every year, our team gets together, not as a corporate function. We gather locally because we truly believe in what we do. We raise money, we make some silly t-shirts, we get out in the community, serve some coffee and donuts, and then we walk or run to raise awareness for breast cancer. I remember one such day several years ago. A total stranger walked up to me and we just began chatting. She informed me she was a breast cancer survivor, and she emotionally told me about her journey. From that fateful day when she got the call from her doctor about something suspicious on her mammogram, to the battery of diagnostic tests she endured, her surgeries, her therapies and treatments, and ultimately to that wonderful day when she proclaimed that she was cancer-free. As she wiped the tears from her eyes, she did something I will never forget. She just reached out and she hugged me. And she thanked me for what we do. I knew working in healthcare had a higher calling. But for that day, for this total stranger that stood before me, I knew that what I did for a living mattered. It mattered to her. I had made a difference in her life. And when you get to experience something like that, it forever changes you and the way that you look at work. It no longer becomes a job or something you have to do. It just becomes who you are and what you do. She then asked me if she could have the t-shirt off my back, and I was very happy to give it to her as a souvenir. In closing, I do not have a crystal ball to tell you where to go to be successful in your career. That's up to you to discover. But I can promise you this. If you keep an open mind, if you learn to love learning, if you dream big and have the courage to follow your vision, if you embrace change, if you try new things and stay curious throughout your life, if you're not afraid to take risks and make mistakes, if you have great people around you, if you give back, and if you're fortunate enough to find what truly inspires you, if you do these things and do them with passion, then I can assure you, you will have a very satisfying career, no matter where your career path takes you. And in your own unique way, you will make a difference in this world. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Polischuk, for sharing your insight and experience with us. I think I can say that I'm not alone in feeling inspired and proud to be in engineering after your lecture. I also like how you split up your presentation into 10 key takeaways, takeaways that can apply to all of us, regardless of our background or industry, whether we're students, faculty, or corporate members. For example, number two, learning to keep learning. Regardless of which industry we're in, we're always going to have to keep learning, and we have to want to keep learning. So thank you, Dr. Polischuk, and how about another round of applause for our 44th Distinguished Lecturer. Now, before you go, we would like to invite Dr. Robert Johansson, head of the Electrical and Computer Engineering Department, to offer a note of thanks and for a gift presentation to our distinguished lecturer.
I will be brief. As Brad mentioned, I came to the University of Saskatchewan as a postdoctoral fellow shortly before he completed his thesis. I was brought here by Professor Kasop after doing a degree at the University of Chicago. And I came here principally because my graduate studies were on amorphous semiconductors, except I was in the silicon field, not the selenium field. I didn't quite see enough of Brad because I did not come in at 8:30 in the morning. So, electrical and computer engineering is this year's host department, and as department head, it is my privilege to thank Dr. Brad Polischuk, the 44th C.J. Mackenzie Distinguished Lecturer. We at the College of Engineering train the engineers that the world needs, and it is always gratifying when alumna or alumnus has a successful career, but all the more so when that career has a significant positive impact on people's lives. Brad, your contributions to medical imaging for women's health will inspire the students here tonight who are on the threshold of their careers to apply their engineering skills to the urgent world problems, such as those in health, sustainability, and climate. I would like to thank Mesha and Jay for the great job that they did as MCs and for representing the students in our programs. And I think they deserve a round of applause as well. I'd also like to thank the students who are here, especially those that put together the displays that many of you visited earlier, and all, of course, the students in the audience who chose to be here instead of studying. I would like to thank the many friends and partners of the college who are here this evening. We very much appreciate your attendance and support, as well as the many ways that you partner with the college throughout the year. I know that our students very much appreciated the opportunity to spend time with you tonight. I'd also like to express our appreciation to the College of Engineering University Relations, especially Carlene Deutscher, who organized this event. I thought it was put on very well indeed, so a round of applause there as well. And I would like to thank Professors Kasop and Brashide, who acted as hosts for today, taking Brad around, showing him his old haunts. And much was the same, right? Not much has changed in our lab, except all that equipment that you saw Brad playing around with there in the images, I finally threw that away about 6 months ago. It had seen its day. I would like to thank the many volunteers who helped with the arrangements this evening and the staff of Prairieland Park for hosting us and for the excellent dinner. The C.J. Mackenzie Gala, as you heard, began in 1976, and the success of tonight's event builds on the work of many faculty and staff who have organized this annual celebration over the past 4+ decades. And in particular, I'd like to thank Professor Emeritus Mel Hussein, who is here tonight, who was central in creating the event, and of course, and for the several of the past distinguished lecturers who are also here tonight. So I'd like to present Brad with a token of appreciation from the college and from your former supervisor. Bring this bag up here. I'm going to go through these one at a time. So here's a book on 100 years of engineering at the University of Saskatchewan. You feel it, you're there somewhere. and excuse me here. You don't want the tissue paper, I presume. Here's a very nice University of Saskatchewan scarf.
Would have been very handy on Sunday.
Yes. And here's a watch which has been engraved with your C.J. Mackenzie Distinguished Lecturer. Now that's from the college. This is from Professor Kassab. Now you might remember that while you were a graduate student, he was writing a book, right? And it was a textbook on materials engineering. And you graduated before it was completed. But it was completed, and this is a copy of it, but it's now in its fourth edition. And so
you finally get a
copy of that. Now, I would like to welcome Mesha, Jay, and Dean Krusta, and Safa as well, to the stage for some photographs. So I don't know if you want to hold that. Wonderful talk.
Can I suggest that we put you on your clothes on the camera here, and we shoot you down here rather than over that white screen? If everybody just comes and stands up here, facing that way.
Okay. We'll only be a minute.
Or two. Okay. Pros on the line. Everybody close. So you're.
Thank you, Dr. Johansson. Now, of course, an evening like this would not be possible without the dedication of one of our very own. Let's give a round of applause for the wonderful work that Carlene Deutscher and her team has put up.
So this marks the close of our event this evening. Thank you all for being here to celebrate engineering and the special accomplishments of our very own Dr. Brad Polischuk. You're most welcome to stay, socialize. The bar is open in the back until 10:30, and there's a photo booth to my left. Photos taken during this evening will be posted on the College of Engineering Facebook page. And make sure to use hashtag CJM2020 when sharing your posts on social media. Thank you, drive home safe, and have a wonderful evening.
Thank you. escape. You're still in my head. I'm running from the emptiness. But I can't escape. You're still in my head. Oh, I'm running from the emptiness. But I can't escape. You're still in my head. Oh, I'm running from the emptiness. Mm-hmm.
sure nobody knew trouble that we got into. In a cab waiting outside, you nearly passed me, but then you asked if I had a light. I told a joke and we shared a smoke or five. I said I ain't got a plan, but we could hang out till the morning, 'cause I don't wanna leave you now. Let's take a long way home, just a little more time alone.
Doing all right, I was all in, I was walking. giving away 30 flights in 30 days with the Air Miles Flight a Day giveaway. It's like your Air Miles card becoming a boarding pass.
Now boarding.
Every time you swipe. Every day from January 9th to February 7th, a $5,000 flight voucher will be given away. Plus, there's a grand prize of a $25,000 flight voucher to be won. So start swiping.
Now boarding.
And fly with the Air Miles Flight a Day giveaway. No purchase necessary. Contest rules apply. Visit airmiles.ca/flight giveaway for full details.
At Fit for Less, we're all about letting you do your thing. Just want to use the hydro massage bed and then walk on the treadmill? That's cool. Want to run on the treadmill? That's cool too. Want to moonwalk on the treadmill? Still cool. Almost too cool. Join the friendly, no judgment gym today at fitforless.ca and pay just $4.99 every 2 weeks with no annual fees. Conditions apply. Fit for Less. Everybody happy.
Here. Life is always changing. Your health insurance should change with it. Let Saskatchewan Blue Cross take care of you.
With Blue Cross's personal health plan, you get 20 core health benefits for less than $13 a month. That includes massage, physio, even vision for less than 50 cents a day. Who knew peace of mind could be so affordable?
Visit your local broker or get a free no-obligation quote instantly at sk.bluecross.ca.
You and my intuition tells me what to do. So watching to the wind. is AccuRadio.